There's been this article recently, a report about a hardware hack. I just thought it'd be interesting to talk to you about what you think about it and whether it's something that is easy to do or is possible.
The original article alleged that certain servers being supplied to companies were being doctored, for want of a better term, with extra hardware being added so that they could then be used to exfiltrate information from the companies. The report seems to have been discredited quite heavily by other parties. Whether it actually happened or not, I don't know. I've not seen any of the servers. I'm not a hardware or cybersecurity expert. But it's certainly an interesting question to talk about. Well, what would you be wanting to do, and why would you want to, say, perhaps do it in hardware? So I've got a server motherboard here. So it's a standard machine, but often servers come with extra support to make them configurable. So this is an Intel Xeon processor, and this is a board management control. When you're installing lots of servers, you will put them in racks of places in your data center. You've got necessary storage, cooling and things. And one of the things you don't want to have to do is, when something goes wrong, you need to reboot a machine, to have to sort of find out where the machine is, turn it off and on again, plug a keyboard and monitor in it to do any sort of maintenance on it. So what modern servers do is they have these chips on there, which are generally computers in their own right, and they enable you to connect to the machine even when it's switched off and do certain things with it, like turn it on, turn it off, and even interact with it. So I've got a machine at home with one of these things in, and if I just bring it up, I'm now connected to it, and it's got various things. So I can look at the sensors, see what the fan speed is. I've got options to turn it off, turn it up, turn it back on again, reset it. On some of them, I can either reflash the BIOS or the UEFI in this case, and generally manage the server, and to the full extent that I can actually bring up effectively a virtual console, a virtual keyboard and display, as it's done here, where I can interact with the machine. So I could log in, put an ISO image of a CD or a DVD in there, and install the operating system from that. Why would you be wanting to do this, and why would you decide to do it via hardware rather than just getting someone to run some malware? And so we need to sort of clock back and think about this. So the alleged, what's happened is that the third party decided they wanted to infiltrate Hackmee computers.
Hackmee computers is made up no identification with actual computer companies living or deceased should be inferred, no animals were harmed during the making of this Computerphile episode.
Hackmee computers had ordered, say, several thousand servers, and so, of course, when you're building that many, it's going to be a special order, so you know probably who they're going to. And the story goes that an extra chip was inserted onto the motherboard of those machines that were destined for Hackmee computers. I fully believe that it's possible to do this. I think there's enough ways you could connect things. And actually, what we're wanting to do, we're wanting to get our code running inside their environment. Now, if you think about a traditional company, the way they traditionally lay out their data centers and their networks is that you'll have a perimeter firewall around things to stop things getting in.
It's a bit like the old-fashioned medieval castle, right? Once you're inside the castle wall,
you've got a moat around it and the drawbridge. If the drawbridge is pulled up, then you can't get in. But if you've got someone inside already, perhaps there's a way, by shining light, shooting an arrow over the walls, that they could communicate. One possibility is that they've added a little bit of extra code into the board management controller, and that chip contains that extra code. And then they've got a machine, okay, a very low-powered one, on the inside of the network. While that board management controller, the BMC, is likely to be on a network which is limited in what it can connect to, it's probably likely to be able to connect to other board management controllers on the same network. And of course, as we've seen, if you can connect to the board management controller, you can then log into the machine. So one potential thing is that they use the board management controller in the same way that we might put a Raspberry Pi or other cheap computer on the network, and then we can use it as a staging post to connect to other things. These board management controllers can also do things like flash the BIOS. And so it's potential that actually this is used as a sort of a staging post to actually attack the machine itself. And again, I think we'd have to assume that they didn't actually know what was going to be running on here. They could probably hazard a guess at the operating system. And unlike the board management controller, that machine probably is likely to be able to connect directly out to the internet, perhaps to download software updates and things. So normally when a machine's running, you have different modes the CPU can be executing in. You have a sort of mode where the machine has access to everything, and that's where your operating system works. And depending whether you're on an x86, an ARM, or a 68000 machine, it might be known as ring zero, kernel mode, supervisor mode. But at that level, you've got full control of the hardware and the machine. And if you can do that, you can then stop it being seen by people using the machines. You can hide it, sort of rootkit, as it tends to be known. But you then got the problem, how do you actually get it running as supervisor mode? And there's two ways you can do it. One, you can find some sort of exploit, some part of the operating system that isn't well written, so that you can get it, trick it to start running your code. And so that's where you see the sort of exploits, things you find some way of tricking the software to do something that it didn't intend to do, make use of that to take control of the system. The other option is that you just get the code loaded in place as the operating system, so you modify the operating system itself. When the machine ships to Hackmee computers, then Hackmee computers will install their operating system of choice, and so you can't modify that then. But how does that operating system get loaded off? Well, that gets loaded off disk by another program called the bootloader. And the bootloader is a program on the disk which gets loaded by the BIOS or the UEFI. And the BIOS or the UEFI, depending on the machine, is on an EEPROM on the motherboard, which can be flashed by the board management controller. And so you can see another potential way that you could hack the machine is that you say, okay, I'll put some hardware on the machine which modifies the board management controller to modify the BIOS of the UEFI, to modify the bootloader after it's been loaded, because the BIOS has the permission to do that at that point, to modify the operating system after that's loaded, to embed the malware I want to get executed. And so it'd be a nightmare to build, because you're writing software which modifies software, which modifies software, which modifies software, and I think I've got the right number of levels of indirection there. Actually, there is another way you could potentially trick things there, in that we talk about ring zero being the lowest level, but actually when we've added support for virtual machines and hypervisors, is now ring minus one, as it tends to be referred to. And so it's potentially possible that you could actually get a hypervisor running before anything else on the machine, and so the machine was running in a virtualized environment that they didn't know about. And so that's another potential way of doing it. And again, you then have access to be able to scrape memory and find things that were there. Software, you can put it on, let it run, delete it, and it's as if it was never there type sort of thing. With the hardware, you can't really get into the data center necessarily and take all the chips out that you've put in there. So you probably will make the chips look like they're meant to be there, like they're something else, or hide them. So the way a modern printed circuit board is constructed, it's a printed circuit board that's got several layers of fiberglass sandwiched together with traces of the tracks of the circuit running through them. So you've got the top layer and the bottom layer, but often several, three or four layers inside as well. These days you've got six layer PCBs and things. The story goes that actually now the chips are so small that they're embedded between the layers of the printed circuit board, so that actually you wouldn't necessarily notice it. I think you'd want to design your hardware exploits to make it look like it was meant to be there. And it's only if you had sort of one with it and one without it that you'd perhaps notice that there was something odd about that machine. Detecting it would be difficult. I mean, the stories that have been sort of suggested are that they're detecting it mainly through odd network access. And so again, that suggests what the software is doing is it's connecting to other machines that perhaps it's not expected to, either inside the company or outside the company, and accessing things in a way that you wouldn't expect it to do. And that is probably your sort of best bet for detecting these sort of things, is are these machines doing what you want them to do? And the best way to do that is to sort of monitor your network and run software which is sort of learning what is expected traffic and non-expected traffic and flagging things, because obviously if you've got a huge data center with thousands of machines in it, spotting the needle in the haystack is a tricky problem. So they may not connect directly to a server and upload it all, but it may well be that they just do a domain name lookup on certain domains depending on certain bits of data being there and stuff, and that's enough to tell people that actually, okay, this machine here has just requested a specific domain that doesn't exist. That means that it's found what we asked it to look for, and we've just returned it a specific IP address, perhaps, that says go and destroy all the machines at Hackmee computers or whatever it is you want it to do.
Which means that we don't tend to use it very often. Horse is much further up the list, so are correct, and batteries further up the list as well. I mean, we all have phones, we talk about batteries all the time. So if you hypothetically picked four words that were in the top 500, then suddenly the search space is 500 to the power of 4.